The normal distribution is a theoretical concept of how large samples of ratio or interval level data will look once plotted. Since many variables tend to have approximately normal distributions, it is one of the most important concepts in statistics. Normal curve allows for probabilities to be calculated. In addition, many inferential statistics require that data are distributed normally. If your data is not normal, be careful what statistical tests you use with it. Normal distribution measures of central tendency, including the mean, median, and mode, all fall at the same midline point. That is, the mean, median, and mode are all equal. The calculation of these measures of central tendency are covered in another video. Normal distribution shares several key features. They are unimodal, meaning that there is only one peak in the distribution. When divided at the mean, a normal distribution takes the form of symmetrical bell-shaped curve. Standard deviations are used to measure how much variation exists in the distribution. Low standard deviations, mean values, are close to the mean, whereas high standard deviation mean that values are spread out over a large range. In a normal distribution, approximately 34% of scores fall between the mean and one standard deviation above the mean. Therefore, based on its symmetry, approximately 68% of scores fall between one standard deviation and the other one standard deviation below the mean. Approximately 95% of scores fall between two standard deviations above and two standard deviations below the mean. And approximately 99.7% of scores fall between three standard deviations above and below the mean. These scores are used to measure how many standard deviations above or below the mean a particular score is. These scores allow for comparison and probability calculations. Not all samples approximate a normal curve. To understand more about distributions, it is important to understand modality, symmetry, and peakedness. A distribution can have more than one peak. The number of peaks contained in a distribution determines the modality of the distribution. Most distributions are normally distributed and only have one mean peak, meaning they are unimodal. However, it is possible to have distributions with two or more peaks. Distributions with two peaks are bimodal, and distributions with more than two peaks are multimodal. Symmetry and modality are independent concepts. Two halves of a distribution can be superimposed on each other, where each half is a mirror of the other image. The distribution is said to be symmetrical. Sometimes, data are not symmetrical. If the peak is off-center, one tail of the distribution will be longer than the other, meaning it is skewed. Skewness is a measure of the symmetry of distributions. Pearson's skewness coefficient provides an non-algebraic quick estimation of symmetry. Recall that normal distributions are symmetrical and bell-shaped. In a perfect distribution, the skewness of coefficient will be equal to zero because the mean equals the median. Positive skewness means there is a pile-up of data to the left, leaving the tail pointing to the right side of the distribution. The tail has been pulled in the positive direction. The data is skewed to the right. In this case, the mean is to the right of the median. Interestingly, positive skews are more common than negative ones. Negative skewness means there is a pileup of data to the right with a long tail in the left side. The tail has been pulled in a negative direction. In this case, the mean is to the left of the median. To remember the meaning of a positive and negative skew, think of pulling on tails. Remember that the tail points towards the direction of the skew. The mean is also pulled in the direction of the long tail of the skew. Kurtosis is a measure of the shape of curve. It is measured if the bell curve is normal, flat, or peaked. Since its calculation is tedious, it is typically done by a computer. Using Fisher's measure of kurtosis, a normal distribution would receive a coefficient of 0 and would be called mesocurtic. The calculation of excess kurtosis results in a large positive number. The distribution is too peaked to be considered normal. This type of data is left according. The curve is taller and skinnier than a normal distribution. The beginning of the word kind of sounds like leap, so think of a skinny guy who leap high in the air. If the calculation of excess kurtosis results in a negative number, it is too flat to be normal. It would be called platycurtic. The curve is shorter and fatter than a normal distribution. One way to remember this is that the beginning of the word kind of sounds like a plateau. The distribution is skewed, there is no need to calculate kurtosis since the distribution is already not normal.
In this video, we'll be learning about z-scores and standardization. By learning about both of these topics, you will learn how to calculate exact proportions using the standard normal distribution. What is the standard normal distribution? The standard normal distribution is a special type of normal distribution that has a mean of 0 and a standard deviation of 1. Because of this, the standard normal distribution is always centered at 0 and has intervals that increase by 1. Each number on the horizontal axis corresponds to a z-score, and z-score tells us how many standard deviation an observation is from the mean mu. For example, a z-score of negative 2 tells me that I am 2 standard deviation to the left of the mean, and that is the score of 1.5 tells me that I am 1.5 standard deviation to the right of the mean. Most importantly, a z-score allows us to calculate how much of the area that the specific z-score is associated with, and we can find out that exact area using something called a z-score table, also known as the standard normal table. This table tells us the total amount of area contained to the left side of any value of z. For this table, the top row and the first column correspond to z values, and all the numbers in the middle correspond to areas. For example, according to the table, a z-score of 1, -1.95 has an area of 0.0256 to the left. To say this in a more formal manner, we can say that the proportion of z less than -1.95 is equal to 0.0256. We can also use the standard normal table to determine the area to the right of any z value. All we have to do is to take 1 minus the area that corresponds to the value. For example, to determine the area to the right of a z-score of 0.57, all we have to do is find the area that corresponds to this set value, and then subtract from 1. According to the table, the z-score of 0.57 has an area of 0.7157 to the left of it. So 1 minus 0.7157 gives us an area of 0.2843, and that is our answer. The reason why we can do this is because we have to remember that the normal distribution is a density curve, and it always has a total area equal to 1 over 100%. You can also use the z-score table to do a reverse lookup, which means you can use the table to see what the score is associated with a specific area. So if we wanted to know what value of z corresponds to an area of 0.8461 to the left of it, all we have to do is find 0.8461 on the table and see what value is that corresponds to. We see to it that it corresponds to a z value. The special thing about the standard normal distribution is that any type of normal distribution can be transformed into it. In other words, any normal distribution with any value of mu and sigma can be transformed into the standard normal distribution, where you have a mean of 0 and standard deviation of 1. This conversion process is called standardization. The benefit of standardization is that it allows us to use the z-score table to calculate exact areas for any given normally distributed population with any value of mu or sigma. Standardization involves using this formula. This formula says that the z-score is equal to an observation x minus the population mean mu divided by the population standard deviation sigma. So suppose that we gathered data from the last year's final chemistry exam and found that it followed a normal distribution with a mean of 60 and standard deviation of 10. If we were to draw this normal distribution, we would have 60 located at the center of the normal distribution because it is the value of the mean, and each interval would increase by 10 since the value of standard deviation is 10. To convert this distribution to the standard normal distribution, we will use the formula. The value of mu is equal to 60 and the value of sigma is equal to 10. We can then take each value of x and plug it into the equation. If I plug in 60, I will get a value of 0. If I plug in 50, I will get a value of negative 1. If I plug in 14, I will get a value of negative 2. If we do this for each value, you can see that we end up with the same value as the standard normal distribution. When doing this conversion process, the mean of the normal distribution will always be converted to 0, and the standard deviation will always correspond to a value of 1. It's important to remember that this will happen with any normal distribution, no matter what value of mu and sigma is. Now, if I ask you what proportion of students scores less than 49 on the exam, It is the area that we are interested in. However, the proportion of x less than 49 is unknown until we use a standardization formula. After plugging 49 into this formula, we end up with the value of negative 1.1. As a result, we will be looking for the proportion of z less than negative 1.1. And finally, we can use the z-score table to determine how much error is associated with his z-score. According to the table, there's an area of 0.1357. According to the table, there's an area of 0.1357 to the left of this z value. This means that the proportion of z less than negative 1.1 is 0.1357. This value is in fact the same proportion of the individuals that scored less than 49 on the exam. As a result, this is the answer. Let's do one more example. When measuring the heights of all students at a local university, it was found out that it was normally distributed with the mean height of 5.5 feet and standard deviation of 0.5 feet. What proportion of students are between 5.81 feet and 6.3 feet tall? Before we solve this question, it's always a good habit to first write down important information. So we have a mean of 5.5 feet and a sigma of 0.5 feet. We are also looking for the proportion of individuals between 5.81 feet and 6.3 feet. All this corresponds to the height. To determine this area, we need to standardize the distribution. So we will use the standardization formula. Plugging in 5.8 to this formula gave us a z-score of 0.62, and plugging in 6.3 into the formula gave us a z-score of 1.6. According to the standard normal table, the z-score of 0.62 corresponds to an area of 0.7324, and the z-score of 1.6 corresponds to an area of 0.9452. To find the proportion of values between 0.62 and 1.6, we must subtract the smaller area from the bigger area. So 0.9452 minus 0.7324 gives us 0.2128. The proportion of students between 5.8 feet and 6.3 feet tall is 0.2128.